Today, I want to talk about pointers in the context of computer programming. More specifically, I will quickly explain what pointers are intuitively, then explain why they exist in computers, motivate their necessity and usefulness to you, and then finish up by introducing you to proper terminology and syntax in C for pointers. Alright, with that out of the way, let's begin. If you are new to computer programming, or come from a background of programming where you never worked with computer systems directly, then pointers may seem foreign and scary at first. However, the notion of a pointer is fairly natural, so let's begin by showing you a rather simple, natural example. Well, first, I actually will provide the definition of a pointer, as it helps to set up the example. A pointer is simply a variable that stores an address of some other variable inside of it. That's all there is to it, really. So, the simplest example of a pointer that I can come up with is a phone contact. Let's keep it as simple as possible and think of a phone contact to be literally a name and a phone number. A phone contact is a variable that is named to the name of the person that you would want to call, and the phone number is simply an address through which to reach the person. I would show my phone right now, but I'm using it to record this video, so words will have to do. Now, I know that not everyone is necessarily good with verbal or textual examples, so let's try and do a visual one this time. Here is Bob. Bob is a human, I think. More stick figure than human, so let's say that Bob is of type stick figure. If you want to reach Bob, you can call him at 167-377-9225. So, in a way, this is Bob's address. So, if you were to store his phone number in some variable such as phone of Bob, then this variable, phone of Bob, would be a pointer variable. Let's give it a type of stick figure pointer, and as you can see, we put 167-377-9225 into phone of Bob, and this is now a proper pointer. While we're here with a visual example, let's make it read like actual C code. Since the name of the variable is reasonable, nothing needs to be changed here. Next, let's look at the type. Assuming that type stick figure actually exists and is defined as something, then to make phone of Bob a pointer, all we need to add is an asterisk right after stick figure. Another thing, the phone number formatting doesn't play along with C, so let's just drop the formatting to make it look like 167-377-9225, and suddenly we have a normal computer address. Would you look at that? It's as close to C as we can realistically get with this example. Anyways, I'm sure I convinced you by now that pointers are a natural phenomenon, so let me quickly explain why they exist in computers. Just a quick heads up, I'm about to get into a quick technical overview of computer architecture. So, if you start to get lost in the details, don't be discouraged and try to look things up on your own time to learn more. So, pointers are actually both a convenience thing for developers and a side effect of how computers work. A computer has very little actual immediate working memory split across these things called registers. When I say very little memory, I am quite serious. On a RISC-V processor, there are a grand total of 32 registers, each of which can store a single integer, and maybe an extra 32 registers that can store floating point numbers, but that's typically an add-on. Now, a program that does anything reasonably meaningful will need far more than just 32 integers worth of storage. So, how do computers get around this issue? Well, it's quite simple. They come with storage in the form of cache memory, RAM, and, well, persistent storage. So, a computer CPU will put information from those registers into storage through store instructions, and then they can later retrieve this information from storage using a load instruction. For the sake of simplicity, assume that the CPU will store that information in RAM. Since the amount of RAM that any given computer has is finite, you can enumerate each byte of storage inside of RAM. This enumeration provides us with an address where you can store information to and where you can get that information from. Cool, that was a lot of very difficult information to swallow. Good job if you stuck all the way through this. Let's keep going though. Taking this one step away from the CPU hardware, you get assembly, which is a language that can be translated very easily into binary, a format that the CPU understands very easily. Typically, an assembly language will give you a way to work with registers directly and provide you with instructions that let you load and store information on the CPU, control what is the next instruction that will get executed, and a set of instructions that perform arithmetic operations on the contents of a register. All right, let's take another step back and look at a low-level programming language, in this case, C. Whenever you define a variable in this language, the information in that variable needs to be stored somewhere. Given what you now know about how the CPU and assembly function, it is not a big reach to assume that this variable will be stored at some address. Again, for the sake of simplicity, just assume that this address corresponds directly to some bytes in RAM. So, C permits you to take the address of any variable and store it as a pointer, which lets anyone knowing the address of the original variable and the type of it access it through the pointer. I am sure that you are convinced now that pointers are a side effect of how computers work, but the fact that pointers are convenient for developers might not sit super well with you quite yet. Let's address that now. I like the textbook example, and everyone that has any programming experience should be able to understand it, so let's use it. The example is passing large objects into functions. I will use C++ for this as it was easier to quickly write my own sample code. I'm a C++ developer after all. Anyway, here I have two functions that do the exact same thing. They take a vector and return the fifth element of that vector. I named them sillyfunc and lessSillyfunc for what will become an obvious reason very quickly. The main difference between the two is that I pass the vector into sillyfunc by value and into the lessSillyfunc by pointer. What does passing by value mean? It means that you create a copy of the original vector and provide this copy to the function. Now, this is a problem. It's a problem because this vector could be huge. As an example, I made mine to have 200 million integers, which means that the storage of all those integers alone takes about 781 megabytes of memory. Copying an entire 781 megabytes of data takes a while, and now just to get the fifth element of this vector, you end up using an additional 781 megabytes of RAM. On the other hand, when you pass things by pointer, you simply have a pointer that you pass in, which takes either 32 or 64 bits of space, depending on your computer's architecture. So, when you pass things by pointer, you use far less space, and you obviously save time that it would have taken to copy the full vector over into the new function. Let's put some numbers to the words and show you how long it took to call sillyfunc and lessSillyfunc on my laptop when the vector has 200 million integers in it. The call to sillyfunc took 993 milliseconds, and the call to lessSillyfunc took about 0.00042 milliseconds, or in other words, around 420 nanoseconds. Trust me when I say that people that write C++ in environments where high performance matters will know just how important pointers are to the overall performance of the system. All right. Let's go back to stick figure Bob and his phone number to wrap up that part of this video. Looking at this diagram, let's explain some terminology about pointers and show how they work a bit more. First, if you were to print out phone of Bob with printf like so, you would get Bob's phone number or, as you now know, his address. However, what can you do with a phone number? You can call it. What would you expect if you were to call Bob's phone number? Well, probably you would expect to reach Bob. If we use proper terminology, then calling Bob through the pointer is called dereferencing a pointer. Dereferencing a pointer will simply go through the pointer and load what the pointer is pointing at and let you work with it. If we're using C, then calling Bob or dereferencing the pointer, phone of Bob, can be done by prepending an asterisk just before the name of the pointer variable. Yes, using the exact same character to both signify that something is a pointer and to dereference a pointer and to multiply is a bit silly, but that is what you have to deal with. Just keep in mind that asterisks in variable declarations are different in meaning from asterisks in regular program statements, as you just saw. All right, now what if you do not know Bob's phone number off the top of your head? How do you get his phone number? Well, it's quite obvious. You just ask. If you want to find an address of a variable in C, then you simply need to prepend an ampersand to the variable that you want to learn the address of. Using the ampersand operator on Bob is effectively the same as asking him what his phone number is. So in this case, ampersand Bob is equal to phone of Bob, just like you would expect. Oh, just one quick comment about this. You effectively never expect to write addresses into variables by hand. You always take the address with an ampersand, as address allocation to variables is handled by the operating system, and it's generally difficult to predict where things will end up before you actually run the program. Alright, this video is now starting to get a bit long, so let me talk about one last thing. You can actually take the address of a pointer variable, and you can store it as a pointer to a pointer. This can be done recursively, almost indefinitely. There are a lot of reasons for wanting to do that, but I will not go into them now. But I want to show a funny code snippet that you should now be able to understand with your knowledge of basic pointer syntax. So, we start with a pointer to an integer called a. Then, we store the address of a into b, then the address of b into c, and so on all the way until e. The type of e is effectively a pointer to 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 an int. At the end, we put the value of a as the address of itself. So, if we print all the things as shown in the code below it, the output will be the same for each print statement, and the last print statement will output the same number 5 times as well. Try to understand how this program works and why all the values are the same on your own time. I'm sure you will have a fun time piecing it together. So, in this video, I ended up explaining to you what pointers are, provided you with a basic overview of the theory behind why pointers even exist, gave you a reason for wanting to use pointers in your program, and even showed you and explained the basic syntax for pointers in C. Now, that was a lot of information. I really hope that I did not lose you in all the details. But hey, at the very least, you now know a lot of the theory behind pointers. However, that is not everything there is about pointers. More advanced topics like pointer arithmetic are important too. Still, you should learn your theory well. For everything else, there is Stack Overflow. Alright, I had a lot of fun making this video, combining both basic C programming and a lot of concepts from computer architecture. So, if you found this video interesting, insightful, or just plain old useful, then please consider liking it and maybe even subscribing to my channel. Either way, thank you for your time. Bye.